want to introduce Gretchen Carey. This is the first of our such sessions. So Gretchen spoke at an ESC committee meeting a few months ago, and we were just blown away by her depth of knowledge and engagement with the topic, and we wanted to share her with all of you. So she is the Sustainability Director for the New England region at Republic Services, which is the hauler that takes our trash and recycle here in town. In addition to that, she is a lead green associate, a zero waste true advisor, and she's the president of MassRecycle, which is a group that promotes recycling knowledge around Massachusetts. So she's going to present some of her great knowledge to us and take questions. So all of your burning recyclable questions, jot it down, remember it, and we'll get to that over the course of this time. So thank you all so much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, Tiana, for putting this together and for everybody who is making this possible tonight. Thank you. Can everybody hear me in the back? Are we good? Okay. All right. I'd like to give a shout out to Caitlin Smith, my colleague at Republic Services, back in the corner there. You'll be seeing her too if you're working with Republic on making progress with sustainability. And thank you so much for coming out on a cold night to spend this time to really learn what's going on in with your waste and in the recycling and sustainability world. It's a big deal that you know, okay? There's a lot of misinformation in the media, and I'll talk more about that. But I'm going to go through a number of different topics, and as I go along, I'm going to talk for a while and then stop and ask questions. I'll take questions on that topic, all right? If you get too ahead of me, I'll just let you know when I'll catch up with you later. Okay. Your town used to be picked up by JRM. Republic Services acquired JRM in the end of the summer, and we like to think that you will be happy to see us on your streets as we go forward. There will be changes in good directions, let's put it that way, okay? Obviously, you're going to be a part of that too. Okay, so Republic Services is the second largest hauler in America. That means we haul things from point A to point B, lots of different things. And as you can see, we are really popular in some places and working on others. But we do have over 36,000 employees, so big, big company. Okay. This is me, only I get a new title, so that's not right anymore. I am now the Sustainability Director for the New England region, as Tiana said. So my job primarily is to help people divert waste from landfills and waste to energy facilities. That's what WTE stands for, waste to energy facilities. We used to call them incinerators. They've gotten better. I am an educator. This is what I enjoy doing, is letting people know what's happening behind the scenes. I am considered an organic waste specialist, and that's our industry term for food waste. All right. There's my address, and you can certainly get in touch with the folks in the back if you'd like to get a hold of me later. And she already said all this other stuff. Okay. I'm going to start off by giving a short tutorial on trash, because hardly anybody knows where their trash goes or what happens to it. All right. For the town of Wakefield, your trash goes to Covanta, which is a waste to energy facility. Okay, goes directly there. There are only two endpoints for trash, all right? Either it's a waste to energy facility or it's a landfill. That's it. That's the end of the road. So if you are, and I'm sure you've all been, stuck behind those big trucks that go very slowly and pick up something and dump it, or a guy runs around and grabs it and then dumps it, right? Those are called packers, and they get surprisingly bad gas mileage. So we ask them not to go any further than they have to. They take your trash to the nearest transfer station. Okay? That transfer station is a gigantic building with gigantic doors for our very big trucks. Right? Here you see this is what we call a roll-off container. It's a dumpster. All right? And this is what we call the tipping floor. Your packer truck would come in and tip all of your trash onto the floor, all right? Then it drives away and goes back to do what it does best. After that, this guy, who is a bucket loader, moves this material around, and meanwhile, at some point, this channel right here is where an 18-wheeler will back down And when he gets to the bottom of it, the top of his truck will be level with the tipping floor. Okay? That means that this bucket loader can now start dumping trash into the top of the 18-wheeler. When he's full, he's going to go one of two places, a waste-to-energy facility or a landfill. Okay? So landfills are what has evolved out of dumps. Okay? In before the 1970s, pretty much every town had a dump. And it was a hole in the ground that you put your stuff into when you didn't want it anymore. And the problem was that at a certain point, well, that stuff would start to break down. And in the 70s, we realized that the stuff that was breaking down was ending up in the water supply. At which point, the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, which is the federal group looking over your clean air and clean water, shut down a whole lot of dumps. All right? And instead, we've now gone over to a better model, which is a sanitary landfill. Which is still a hole in the ground in which you put things you don't want. However, there's something that's like the equivalent of a very thick pool liner on the bottom of that hole. And that keeps things that have broken down from getting into that water supply below. All right? The other thing that we do is that we, at the end of the day, after we've pushed trash into the landfill, we're going to cover it over with 4 inches of something we call ADC, alternative daily cover. And that could be anything from paint, glass, dirt, you name it. It's going to be some sort of barrier, some sort of physical barrier that's going to keep the seagulls out and the rats out and the rain out. The reason being, we do not want things to get wet underground if we can help it, because then they begin to break down if they're organic. Anybody know what happens when organics break down underground with no oxygen? They create methane. Okay, it's a greenhouse gas. So we want to limit that. So the whole point of landfilling something, the goal is to mummify your trash. It's pretty different than what most people think. You know, I don't know about you, but I know I've met plenty of people who, you know, have bought the wooden coffee stirrer because that way it'll break down in the landfill. We don't want that. Okay? All right. So the other option is a waste energy facility, which is where your material is going. This used to be, if anybody comes from the country, I do, the burn pile. When you had stuff you wanted to get rid of, you literally just burned it. At a certain point, we got smarter than that, okay, and then started putting them in buildings where they would burn it. And now they burn it and make energy out of it. So all of that material is, but if you put in 10 tons, you are left with 1 ton of ash at the bottom. They can recover the metal out of it, and electricity is made out of all of the heat that produced. Right? There are, and people always ask this, there are a ton of regulatory eyes on what is coming out of that smokestack. Okay? Covanta in particular, I can speak to. I've taken the tour several times, and believe me, the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection is all over that, okay? So that is trash. I'll take 2 questions. Anybody have anything? I don't want to take too long. Where is Covanta? Yours is in Haverhill. That's where your trash is going, okay? Nice people. Okay, so while everybody in this room is probably recycling for the right reason, because it's the right thing to do, there are actually regulations about this in Massachusetts. Best kept secret ever. Okay, not in a good way. All right, so in the 1990s, the DEP realized, the state realized, we were going to be running out of landfill space. All right, we only have so many waste energy facilities and so many landfills, we had a whole lot more back then. Because the funny thing about landfills is they are holes in the ground that fill up over time. Okay, so they recognized that there was a lot of useful material going into those holes in the ground, and they said, rather than saying that you have to recycle, which is an unfunded mandate, we're going to say that you cannot put this material in the trash, and that's called a waste ban. All right. So, in the 1990s, they made waste bans on things that you would definitely recognize. So for instance, your bottles, your cans, your paper, your cardboard, all right? All of that, your plastic containers. Also, yard waste. You notice that has to be picked up separately, right? Your white goods, which are things like refrigerators and stoves. And tires. We don't want those things in the trash. They have to be picked up separately. So you know a lot of these without necessarily knowing the rule, if that's the case. In 2014, they took it up another notch because they realized we don't have enough space for the trash that we create here. And so they said, if your facility makes more than 1 ton of food waste per week, you have to divert it out of the trash to do something better with it. That facility that we're describing is a hospital or a college or university. Okay, it's a big facility, it's not a small thing. As of last year, they took that down to a half a ton. So now there's a lot of restaurants involved, right? And that material means that it's not, it is being handled locally for the most part. So some of it is being composted and some of it is going to what's called an anaerobic digester, all right? Which literally means without air. All right. When I talked before about putting food waste or organic stuff underground without oxygen, we do that on purpose in that container. We put it in, the food waste is in there, there's no oxygen, it's a contained situation, and the bacteria go to work and create methane. And that methane is tapped to make electricity. This is a renewable energy source. All right. When you have composting, it's literally throwing it on the ground outside and it breaks down because of all the oxygen that's there and bacteria. And it's been going on a long time before humankind got here, okay? It will continue long after us. Okay, I felt this was necessary. Yes, because the media has said a lot of really negative things lately, all right? I'll just say there's some money behind all that talk. Right? I'll leave it at that. But what you should know is that in Massachusetts, recycling is alive and well. Right? We had a tough year in 2018. I will not kid you. That was when China, who had been the world's biggest buyer of recycled material, said no. Just walked away from the table, from the entire world. It wasn't just us. But we're a port city here in Boston, the whole area, and therefore a lot of our stuff had gone to China. No more. No more. So that was rough. And what happens when suddenly your biggest buyer walks away means that there's a lot of material available and hardly anybody wants to buy it, and the price just plummets, okay? So we have recovered since then. We had a very good summer, and we are back at it, all right? So don't think that was a permanent problem for us. It's a market. It corrects itself eventually, and we are taking your material and doing something worthwhile with it. It is our goal to make sure that we recycle as much of your material as possible because we sell it. Okay? Can I convince you that my business wants to make money? Anyone? Want to take that? So we are taking that, and Caitlin and I will take you on a tour so you can see it yourself if you would like at the Greenworks facility. It's our recycling facility up in Peabody. So keep that in mind if you're interested. All right. In where? I'm not sure which plant you're referring to. Sorry. Oh, wheel operator? I don't know Lynn. I know Saugus. I don't know Lynn. Okay. Yeah, that's wheel operator, correct. Thank you from the help in the crowd. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to go into some industry terms. These are words that people use interchangeably, and they are not the same thing, okay? So in order to have the same vocabulary, I'm going to explain what they really mean. Reusable. This means that the item will be used again in the same condition that it is now. If my daughter outgrows her clothing and I hand it to my niece, she's reusing it. If my bowling days are over and I hand my bowling ball to my best friend, that's reuse. I want all of these items to have a second life. They should go in a donation bin, most likely next to a church, a school, somewhere in your community, okay? Maybe even picked up at your doorstop with, you know, a bag, okay? So donation items, there's a whole lot going on here. They will happily take a lot of these items, but whatever bin you're looking at is most convenient for you, give them a call if you're wondering what they take. Some of them will take household items, they'll take clothes, they'll take everything. Some only want clothing, some will take stuffed toys. Ask, ask the question, because dumping things on them means they have to pay to get rid of it somehow, so you're not helping them if it's not what they want, much like the recycling facility. All right, so I would love to see these items, particularly clothing, all right, and there's now, as of last year, a textile ban. Anybody know that? Hands in the air if you knew that already? You guys are pretty educated. Okay, so textile ban means that you should no longer be throwing anything that is a textile into the trash. Why? Because it has a lot of use ahead of it, no matter what it looks like, all right? The only thing they do not want is wet and mildewed. You can forgive them for that, I'm sure. So we're looking for your curtains, your throw rugs, your towels and blankets, your clothing, your shoes, your hat, your belt, your bags, all of that, all right? And just in case you're thinking that no one will ever wear this shirt, it is so worn out, throw it in anyway, all right? What's gonna happen is about half of the things you throw in are going to be reused again, use that word, and as in the same condition that they are now. A portion of the rest of it will instead be downcycled into rags. They're going to cut them up into rags, and they're going to sell them to painters and mechanics. Right? And the stuff that they can't do that with, because it's not the right fabric or it's not big enough, they're going to shred it and use it for things like automobile seats, stuffing. Okay? So there's a whole wide world of textile reuse, recycling, and all of the above out there. So please don't think twice about throwing it in without its button, without its zipper, broken zipper, whatever it is, okay? The next two get mistaken for each other all the time. Compostable means if you throw it on the ground outside, it will break down and become part of the planet, right? So it means that if I take an apple and throw it in my front yard, in 6 months, what will have happened to it? It'll have disappeared in some icky sciencey way. It will have bacteria will have taken it, worms will have taken it, and it will have literally been broken down to its components and be dirt. That's composting. Right? Recyclable means mankind made it and mankind will have to break it down in order for it to be made into something new. If I take a water bottle and throw it in my front yard, in 6 months, what will have happened to it? Nothing. 6 years? Nothing. 60 years. Plastic doesn't break down, it breaks up into microbeads. Okay? It doesn't go away. If we don't want to be neck deep in water bottles, we need to recycle them. Right? And there's a lot of, I don't know, there's some misinformation going on about what exactly recycling is. If you take something and make something new out of it, you do not have to use virgin material that way. That's what the point of recycling is. If you make paper out of paper, it means you don't have to cut down trees. If you turn your metal can into another metal can, or an airplane, or a train, or a bicycle, it means that you did not have to strip mine a mountaintop to get that metal, because that's the only two ways on this planet you get metal. It's either strip mining, or what's in my bin. So don't lose sight of why we are recycling, okay? All right, so there's one category that overlaps here between compostable and recyclable. Anybody got an idea of what that might be? You can both compost it and recycle it?
Paper,
very nice. Okay, if your paper is covered with food, please compost it or throw it out. If you don't have composting. If your paper is clean, I will take it in the recycling bin to make new paper out of it, okay? Or it might be made into toilet paper, napkins, paper towels, all that good stuff that we need every day, all right? But you're saving trees by throwing it in.
What about the paper that's shiny? It looks like it's coated in plastic. Can that be composted or?
I would not compost anything that looks like it's plasticky. You don't want that. It's okay if it's got, you know, printing on it and that sort of thing, but I would not try to recycle, not try to compost plastic.
Recycle that.
Also, okay, so I'll give you the rule a little early. I'm gonna go through all the different categories of recycling and what we'll take and what we won't. But if you can rip it, you can recycle it, is the general rule, okay? I'm gonna give you some high level rules. there's going to be little things that will go on. If you come home with it, you can rip it, you can recycle it, and remember that, I won, okay? So, all right. Any questions about compostable, recyclable, and reusable? Yeah. Okay, if you leave food, let's say peanut butter in the bottom of your jar, okay? I'll explain this again later because there's part of it, but the idea is that it will not get sorted properly if it is heavy with food. Okay, that's the short version, so thank you for asking, including if you left the water bottle, not that any of you are using water bottles because you've all got your own, but if you had left, say, half of the soda in your soda bottle, it will not sort properly either. I saw a question in the back, and then I'll move on.
What happened to the relationship that I think our town had with simple recycling, with those pink bags?
I know of simple recycling, but I can't answer that question for you, I'm afraid. Okay. If there's somebody here who can, I'd be happy to have them.
We still use simple recycling.
We still use them. Okay, so apparently you are still working with Simple Recycling. You don't have to use the pink bag anymore, and if you just call them up, they will come and get it, and you can put it in whatever bag you like. Schedule a pickup. Okay. Thank you for wanting to recycle. I'll take one last one. Oh, I'm getting to that. Okay. Jumping ahead. Okay. So in 2018, when the recycling world went completely sideways, we decided that we needed to make recycling simpler. Okay, and so the Department of Environmental Protection got together with all of the recycling facilities, and they said, tell us everything you want in the bin, and we put it on the top line. And then tell us everything you do not want in the bin, and they put it on the bottom line. Okay, so all of us agreed to take the same stuff. Okay, that way we have statewide guidelines. Doesn't matter who's picking up, where they're taking it, if it's in Massachusetts, it's leaving your house, school, church, whatever it is, you follow these rules, okay? The only exception is out in Springfield. Anybody going to Springfield often? Okay, good enough. All right, so start with cans. Cans, what we're looking for in metal is cans. Cans that you or your pet ate or drank out of, right? I want soup cans, I want cat food cans, dog food cans, and soda cans, okay? That's it. I want them empty and clean. If you're the person saying, but it takes a lot of water to get these things clean, please don't do that. Don't waste resources to save resources. I want you to take a quick rinse and a scrubby brush. Get in there, get it clean, dump it out, okay? If you are wondering if you can leave the label on, if, for instance, it's too hard for you to take the label off, if you leave the label on, I will still get the metal out of it, okay? If, however, you want to recycle the paper, please separate it from the can so that the paper can go one way and the can can go another in the recycling facility. Okay, and yes, clean and empty every time. Dry would be awesome too. People ask, how clean do things need to be? In general, I should not be able to tell what was in there, okay? Oh, look, dog food. Okay, you haven't cleaned it enough, okay? However, we are not going to be eating out of it after you are, okay? So it doesn't have to go through the washing machine unless that's like your cheat, okay? If that makes you happy, that's fine. I'm gonna come back to plastics because that's a story. Bottles and jars, glass, we'll take any color. We are just looking for wine bottles, beer bottles, pickle jars. Maybe your olive oil, and the trick to things like things that are thick, like olive oil, cooking oil, or even laundry detergent, put the lid on tight, turn it on its head, and leave it overnight on the counter. In the morning, get your money's worth, then take their bottle and take an old napkin, a dirty napkin, a paper towel, whatever you've already used, not something clean, something used, clean out the inside of the neck, clean out the cap, put them back on together, okay? Throw it in the bin. That's as clean as it needs to be, all right? I don't work any harder than I have to. Anytime I can get gravity to do a job for me, I will. Paper, and cardboard. Oh, in case you're wondering, the pickle jar with the metal lid, I will totally take that metal lid. Okay, I will use a magnet later to pull that lid out of the situation, out of the sorting. Okay, the pickle jar will go a different direction. I will show you all of this. I'm going to take you on a tour, you know, visual tour later on of all the different parts and how they work. So, in case you're wondering, we got that ahead of us. All right, mixed paper. So, paper and cardboard. If you can rip it, you can recycle it. I will take anything from your Sunday news, your junk mail, your cardboard boxes. Definitely want those, okay? I want them flattened, please. Why? They take up a lot less space in our truck that way. If everybody left their boxes big, we'd never make it half the route, okay? And I will take, nowadays, ready for it? Pizza boxes, okay? This was a huge no, and I gotta say there was a big hiss when all of us recycling coordinators heard this because we campaigned so hard against it. But anyway, cardboard is desirable because they need to make more cardboard boxes. They need your cardboard, all right? So therefore, they're willing to take the bit of grease that's in the bottom. So here's what I'm going to say about pizza boxes. I want your box. I do not want the paper, the pizza, and the little Barbie table. I don't want any of those, okay? If there's a little grease on the bottom, that's okay. If you're looking at the bottom of the box and saying, my God, what have I done to my arteries? I don't want that cardboard, okay? Just rip it off. Give me the top half, all right? Okay, here we go. Plastics, are you ready for this? Okay, this is such a point of confusion. All right, so there is a number on the bottom of pretty much every plastic. It is called a resin code. It tells us what kind of plastic we're looking at, all right? And there's 1 through 7. There is a special place in hell for the person who put the triangle around all of those numbers because they are not all recyclable in my bin. I do not want your styrofoam. I do not want your plastic bags, and I don't want your PVC pipe, okay? So we have decided to get away from the numbers to make it easier, okay? So the new rule is, can you hold it in your hand and say that it is a container with a lid? Okay? I want water bottles, soda bottles, laundry detergent jugs, peanut butter jars, and margarine tubs. I do not want Legos or dog toys, okay? Or obscure plastic things that you found that like came in the pack with the Barbie and there's all those plastic pieces. They are not gonna make it through my system, okay? So, is it a container with a lid? If you hold it in your hand and can answer that question, yes, I'm happy to have it. If it's clean and empty, please, all right? That way it'll get sorted properly. You can keep the lids on them. Thank you, that's a great question. The lid is made of plastic. We want that too. So please put the lid back on. And with bottles, if you scrunch them just a little bit and then put the lid back on. Obviously, you've drank all of the liquid. Okay, but it helps us a little bit because it just sorts better, all right? So don't make them flat. I know like the whole crushing the beer can thing is super manly, but do not, please don't make them flat, okay? Things that are two-dimensional when they come into our recycling facility get sorted into the paper pile. So that means that those Amazon mailers that, I don't know, say they're recyclable, they're gonna end up, the plastic white ones, the bubbles, they're gonna end up, take them somewhere else. They're gonna end up in my paper pile. And that's not helpful, okay? So two-dimensional versus three-dimensional. The other thing that I will take in metal, okay, which I hadn't mentioned earlier, aluminum foil. All right, everybody wonders about this one. So there's certain things about aluminum foil you should know. Okay, first of all, if it is a chafing dish, because you had a party, the party, man, you had chafing dishes and a buffet going on, the clean ones that just had water in them, shake them off, throw them in. I'll totally recycle, I'll take those, okay? We appreciate that aluminum. If it had chicken parmesan in it, just give it up, okay? Just trash it, because you're gonna spend so much water cleaning that out that it's not worth it, okay? And it still may not come clean in the end. So the same thing with that blueberry pie, probably not gonna, you know what I mean. Okay, so I will take those two. If it's tin foil, the flat type, and you put it over top of a salad, shake it off, ball it up, okay? If it is flat, it will end up in my paper pile. So I want a metal ball that I can pick out easily and put into my aluminum pile. And you feel free to like add pieces of aluminum foil to each other and make a bigger ball, you know, make it fun. No? Okay. Any questions about the top line? All right.
The plastics that you get from leftovers at your restaurant, you know, put them in the container. Does the container have to be a special color?
Ooh, good question. Okay. Yeah, it's an advanced question. Thank you. So we will take any color of plastic except black. Okay. This is a problem for us because our computerized optical sorters can't see black on the conveyor belt. Okay, so thank you for asking. I suggest all of you get together with a couple of friends at your favorite restaurant, takeout restaurant, and say, how does white sound instead of black? Or how about hot pink? Any color is fine except for the black, unfortunately. Okay, I saw another hand in here somewhere.
I had that question.
Oh, same question, same advanced question. Very nice. Okay, in the back. Can you give me an example? Yeah. Plastic metal lid. Do you mean like Pringles cans or? Okay. Okay. All right. So if it's a glass jar with a plastic lid, I won't be able to capture that plastic. Okay. If it's a plastic jar with a plastic lid, I'll take that. Okay. And what happens is we're going to take those, let's say, water bottles where they're PET, they're clear water, clear plastic, and then they have a white cap a lot of times, right? We're going to use both those plastics. When we melt them down, chip them up and melt them down, they will end up in two different levels because they're different chemistry. And then we'll take the top part and make things out of it, and take the bottom part and make different things out of it, okay? So we'll take all that plastic. One more, and then I'm going to move on. Clamshell.
Yeah, the clamshell. Can
they be recycled? Is it a container with a lid?
Yes.
There you go. See how smart you are already. Okay. Go ahead, sir. You look so sad. Okay.
Milk containers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Milk juice.
Okay. So here's the short version. If you don't see it here, don't put it in. Okay. You can use that to educate other people who are just not as interested as you are in recycling. But in general, if you don't see it there. If you are the sort of person who wants to know about things, like as soon as I leave the room, you're like, oh, I forgot to ask. Go here. Okay? This is a great website. You can get this downloadable printable flyer. You can also, there's a search bar there called a recyclopedia that has over 400 searchable terms. And if you don't find your term, you write to them and they will add it. Okay? So they're really good about giving you answers. I'll get back to you. Okay. Milk cartons, it's a great question. All right, so they used to be recyclable, all right? They are no longer. The problem is that, like I said, we really want paper over here and plastic over here. Anything that's a multiple layer of paper and plastic and wax and foil is really hard for us to deal with, okay? So that means your gable top cartons, this is my next slide, but I'll give it away. My gable top cartons of milk and orange juice. And the other thing is soup in a box or almond milk, soy milk, and all of those. So I'm sorry. I know. We're all, yeah, fans of, I get. But unfortunately, I can't do anything with that. All right? Yes.
What about junk mail?
I'll take your junk mail.
Okay. So
I'm the only one who wants it.
Oh, sure. Sure. Are not recyclable.
The address labels are not great for us. You were right about that.
But can you, yeah.
But in general, it's an incredibly small portion of the junk mail. Okay.
So, can they separate that out? I mean, can you get the paper out of that?
Yeah. It's a little better if you open it up and then throw it in, just so that we can sort out, you know, things from each other. So thank you. That does bring me back to the point, though, of what we will take here. Okay, which is important. So, all right. We will take staples, binder clips, paper clips, sticky tape, labels, and windows and envelopes. All of that is just fine, okay? What happens, I actually went to a paper manufacturing plant and got to see this, which is super cool, is that they take a whole bunch of paper and they put it in a vat. And by this I mean a two-story vat, okay? They throw in a bunch of water with it and they hit it like a blender, okay? It is now breaking up all that paper and it ends up looking like oatmeal. It's wood pulp, all right? But it's wood pulp with staples, binder clips, paper clips, all kinds of things going around. Totally okay, because at the end, after it's really well blended, they're going to put that whole thing through a filter. So all of the paper pulp comes through, and all of the metal and plastic and tape is left on the filter. What we do not want is food. You don't want to be making paper out of gravy and tomato sauce and all of that, okay? So we appreciate it if you keep your paper clean. I'll take one more question, then I'll go on to the bottom row. Yeah?
Receipts. I think I read something about...
Okay, so here's another rule for you. Anything smaller than a credit card will fall through my system. Legos, dog toys, etc. Utensils. Receipts. Okay, shredded paper. Anything smaller than a credit card will fall through my system. And I'll show you where. Okay? All right, I'm going to start on the bottom line here. Please do not bag your recyclables. This was a thing 4 or 5 years ago. The problem is that we don't want to rip open bags because people put all kinds of things in bags. It's dangerous for our workers, all right? So we ask you to keep it loose, as we say, and please just put your container put your recyclables into whatever container you have. A paper bag is not a problem. Don't close the top of it. Don't staple it shut or anything else. That becomes a bag we can't see into. But please, no plastic bags in particular. We hate them so much we put it here twice. Okay. We have machinery with moving parts, spinning parts, in fact, rods with spinning discs, much like the beater bar of your vacuum cleaner, which means that as soon as it hits something that is flimsy and stretchy, it goes wrapping right around it, right? And we have to stop the entire line and cut them off, at least every shift. So tanglers are what we call these things, okay? Tanglers are also ropes and chains and Christmas lights and the arms of your sweater, okay? So anything that can get wrapped around. The best place for these plastics, anybody know? Grocery store, thank you. All right, so you are welcome to take these back to the grocery store you got them at. I'm not sure if you have a ban here in this town. Fantastic, love that. Okay, so if you have gone to, let's say, someplace else, you forgot your bags, ended up with a plastic bag. Most places that have them or used to have them have a box in the kind of that double door situation in the middle, and they will take not only your plastic bags, but they will take your dry cleaning bags, your Sunday morning paper bags, your bread bags, your Ziploc bags, okay? Anything that can be stretched over your thumb is a plastic that they will take. Anybody know where that plastic goes? Obscure knowledge. That goes to a company called Trex, which makes composite lumber out of it. So it becomes decking and park benches. They add that plastic to sawdust and create a new material entirely. So at this point, I mentioned before that I am the president of, one moment please. I mentioned I was a president of a statewide nonprofit called MassRecycle.org, okay, MassRecycle. And you wanna write it down because everything has the word recycle in it and mass in it, so you won't remember it when you get home, I'm just saying. MassRecycle, okay, I do a podcast there because there was just so much misinformation at different points, especially in 2018. There was so much information to get out about how things had changed that we started a podcast, my vice president and I. We are now on episode 37. So if you want to know anything about anything in the waste world, it's probably there, including an interview with a lady from Trex. So if you want to know what to bring, where to bring, how you can start a system in your own school or train, please listen to the podcast, okay? Lots of good answers there. Mm-hmm.
You mentioned real quickly, Whole Foods takes the plastic utensils that you get with takeout.
Okay, so Whole...
They told me that that's used for decking.
Okay, so Whole Foods is collecting utensils that you get would take out for decking as well. Okay, great, thank you. Yes, in the back?
What about cellophane? That's not plastic, is it?
No, I don't have anything I can do with cellophane, I'm afraid. Craft projects, that's about all I got. Okay, we do not want food or liquid. The way we put it is, we want your containers, we do not want the food and drink that came with them, okay? And once again, that's because they don't sort properly, and I'll show you in a minute what that means. We want no clothing or linens. Once again, we'd like you to give that a second life, but it should go in a donation bin. It's bad for us, okay? And no tanglers. All right, any questions on the whole thing? Anything I haven't gotten to yet? Yes?
So you've done all this preparation, you put it in your recycle bin, and it breaks.
We hate that too. Yeah. Okay, so you wait till the next week or something? Yeah. We don't like wet paper, but it's a hazard of the job. Okay. So we appreciate you looking out for it, and certainly if you have the option to hold on to it until the next week, that's awesome. Okay? We like dry paper much better than wet paper. Any other question? Thank you for thinking of it. Oh, I've got one for that too. Okay, so you got a metal can, you crank the dog food or the soup can lid off first, okay? And I want you to clean out the can carefully, because now it's a little sharper on the edges, right? Okay, and clean off the lid, please. And then put one inside the other and crimp it a little bit with your hand. Not much, but that'll keep the lid inside so you don't get hurt, I don't get hurt, nobody on my line gets hurt, okay? Thank you. Okay. Moving on. All right, so we've talked about a couple of these things already. Waxed gable top cartons are out. Multi-layered sterile containers are out. That's soup in a box. That's soy milk, almond milk. Cups are out. Okay, there's two levels of education here. Because you're willing to sit for an hour and learn all these details, I'm going to tell you the secret on this one. But in general, when you're talking to anyone else, cups are out. The reason being, not so much, and I'm talking coffee cups, paper cups, plastic cups, right? Everything. Reason being that every other person who recycled their cup also threw in the lid, the straw, the ice, the slushy, the smoothie, oh, the coffee, you name it, okay? And ruined everybody else's good recycling. So we don't want that mess. Therefore, we have pushed back on cups. That said, if you are setting up a system and you need to know this, or you are the person who is industrious enough to take my advice on this one, okay, clear plastic cups are okay. So if you've gone to, say, Starbucks, Dunkin' Donuts, and you've got an iced tea, I'll take that clear, cold cup. I do not want the lid, I do not want the drink, I do not want the ice or the straw, okay? That lid is gonna flatten out, end up in my paper pile, that straw is gonna fall through my system. It's a size thing. It's a how many dimensions thing, okay? But if you're, you know, in an office or setting up a system where you're gonna have cups for visitors and then you have a recycling bin and say here, right there, that's okay, okay? medical waste is out. Now this is in quotes because it's what my industry calls medical waste as opposed to what people in hospitals call medical waste. It's very different. But anything that looks like it came out of a laboratory is not welcome in the bin. People were very generous about what they threw into the bin before. It was pretty scary. Okay, so we have moved away from that. and empty pizza boxes are in. And I always have to put this because somebody in the crowd usually freaks out. You're all local, so you won't. But City of Boston has a system whereby they put recycling out to the curb in a plastic bag. So when I've gone off on plastic bags, somebody always panics. It's okay. If you're a Bostonian, you're supposed to. Any questions on all of that? Yes?
What's a multi-layered sterile container?
That is soup in a box or soy milk, almond milk. So it's got, you know, plastic and paper and foil. It's way more than we can deal with. Okay, that's what medical waste looks like. Medical waste. If anybody has a question about that, you're welcome to talk to me afterwards. No, it was a very big deal to me. So, yeah, 2018, I had to go into every hospital and laboratory that was our customer and tell them, sorry. Yes.
empty pill bottles.
Okay. All right, here we go. So empty pill bottles. All right, so anything smaller than a credit card is going to fall through. So chances are very good those yellow, orange containers are going to fall through, so I don't want them. You also don't want your information going to be handled again, okay? If you have a vitamin jar, that'll make it through, okay? So go ahead and throw that in. But once again, think about the credit card, okay? Okay, so I'm gonna take you on a tour, a virtual tour, of a recycling facility. We call it a material recovery facility, or a MRF. Say it with me now, MRF. MRF, thank you, because it's just way too long to be saying over and over again. Okay, so we are going to take all of your recycling and dump it on the tipping floor. That's where it gets tipped, on the floor. And then we're going to move it around a lot and then put it up a conveyor belt. Oops. Where our people can get to it. The entire job of these people is to pull out things that are tanglers. They're going to break our system. They're our first line of defense to protect our machinery, okay? These people are also the reason I ask you, when I'm talking about recycling glass, not to throw in broken windows and mirrors, because they have a way of breaking in big dagger-shaped pieces. We want our people to go home in the same condition they came in. It's also a good reason to not leave food on your containers, because while it sat in your bin for a week, and then it takes a little while to get to us, and then sits on our floor for a little while, it's pretty much a biohazard at that point, so be kind. Thank you. Okay, the first mechanical sorting is by size. Cardboard is bigger than pretty much everything else. So we have rods with spinning discs set apart from each other. So the cardboard goes over top because it's big, and everything else falls through. This is what happens when tanglers get to those rods and spinning discs. This poor guy, it's his job, you know, probably every shift, to cut whatever that tangler was. It looks like it was pieces of fabric that somebody thought would be useful. Yeah, it's not useful to us, okay? It's a huge hindrance. And it is a, it ruins our efficiency, okay? So please, if you don't see it on that top line and Recycle Smart, don't throw it in. All right, everything but cardboard continues on. That's plastics, metals, and glass. The glass, then everything goes across this, which are kind of spiky bits coming up and bouncing things along. The glass gets broken. This is where it gets broken into like 2-inch pieces. This is where anything smaller than a credit card will fall through and end up in my glass pile, where I don't want it. Okay. So here's my glass pile. All right. There's lots of other things in it besides glass. In the back there, you can see shredded paper. Okay. And everything that I'm telling you, okay, any mistakes you might have made, I forgive you. Okay. I would not know any of this if I hadn't become a professional and spent a lot of time touring and learning these things, okay? So I personally used to shred my paper, and then I would put it in a paper bag, and then I would turn over the top and staple it, and I would write shred on it. So then when it got to the recycling facility, they would know what it was. And then one day I was touring, and I saw a bag just like mine, and I went, oh, look! And at that point, the machine backed over it, and it went, poof! Like a ticker tape parade, at which point I went, okay, that wasn't how I thought this would end. So please don't give us your shred. If you take it to a place like, I'll say Staples, or it's a shred day, they almost always, and you feel free to ask, they almost always have an arrangement with a vendor who will then buy all of that shredded paper and make it into more paper. Okay, it's perfectly good office paper most of the time. So I have seen these bales, I have pictures of these bales. It's going to a good end, all right? At this point, ferrous metals will be pulled out with a magnet. Anybody know what's in ferrous metal? Oh, you guys are smart, okay. Okay, plastics are run through a computerized optical sorter. This means it's a machine that uses a computer eye, and it sees things as it goes by, and it sees the color, the transparency, and it says, oh, you're a milk jug. And then it hits it with a puff of air, Okay, it's working remarkably fast. Puff of air makes that plastic container jump into a particular bin. All right, so here, right there, you're seeing it jump, okay? Which is fantastic, unless somebody left half the water in the water bottle, in which case that puff of air doesn't do anything. Doesn't jump, it just lays there and misses its exit, okay? So please get your money's worth when buying containered drinks, all right? So that's that, that's the one that can't see black, okay? Can't see black plastic. All right, paper runs over another set of discs and then goes through a hand sorting. Anybody know what we're looking for there? Gravy, tomato sauce, all those things we don't want in the next batch of paper that we're going to make out of it. Non-ferrous metals, okay, such as soda cans will be separated out, and it's actually in either by hand or in what's called an eddy current. I'm still understanding what an eddy current is. It's a magic box that pulls out aluminum cans, okay? But anybody want to tell me what that aluminum can might be in its second life? Another can. What'd you say? Toyota. He's right. I've owned those. Okay. So, yes, they will be cars. They will be bicycles. They will be airplanes. Okay. Anything made out of metal can be made out of recycled metal. Same thing with all your soup cans. They just become bulldozers. And yes, you name it. Things made out of metal. Okay. Anybody want to take a guess at what plastic water and soda bottles will become? Sorry?
Is it going to be mixed up with the sawdust and become?
That's plastic bags. Not the water bottles, no way. They got a better life ahead of them. Okay, so plastic water bottles will be made into usually either more plastic water bottles or polyester fiber. You are all wearing water bottles right now, okay? So you're probably walking on the carpet made out of water bottles. This stuff is absolutely everywhere. So your hats, my laptop bag, okay? This is water bottles, right? Yeah, many things made out of polyester are made out of water bottles, all right? They have a great second life. So in case you're thinking, you know, you hear a lot about if you put your water bottle in the bin, we won't use it, it'll get thrown away. We make money if we sell it to somebody. We have to pay if we throw it away. We're a business. I'm going to leave it at that, okay? We want to make money off of what we can. That's our goal. And there's not always a market for it. That depends. But when there is a market, you know, we're gonna work towards the goal of always getting as much out as possible. We're always optimizing the machines and trying to do it better. All right, so to recap, why is it that we don't put big, sharp glass items in our bin? Okay, all those nice people working, right? Okay, styrofoam, people are fascinated by this one. Okay, so styrofoam, we do not take it in the bin. Reason being, there's no financial model for recycling it, okay? Styrofoam is literally plastic bubbles filled with air. That's why it's super light. The way you recycle it is to heat it with a giant hairdryer. It's called a densifier. That causes the air to expand, the bubble to pop, and it melts down. The problem is it takes about 4 18-wheelers full of styrofoam to melt down to a cube about this big. And it's not worth $1 million. It's not worth much at all. And so therefore, I have now sorted, transported, and heated this material that I cannot make any money off of. So there used to be a couple that ran across the state, you know, doing different styrofoam recycling days, and they finally went out of business. So it's a sad thing, but yes, use less styrofoam if possible. Plastic bags and plastic wrap should go back to the grocery store. Thank you. No food and drink. We want your containers. We do not want the food and drink that came in them. Greasy pizza boxes. We will take your clean cardboard, okay? You make that decision. And black plastic containers, we talked about how they can't be seen. Okay, baled materials. Once we have a giant pile of something, I'm talking water bottles over here, milk jugs over here. We will take a pile of it, we will put it in a machine that then crushes it all together, wraps a wire around it, and makes a bale like a bale of hay. Only it's a 2,000 pound bale, okay? So these are big. Here's one coming out here, paper. We pile them up like bricks, like Legos, and we wait till we have enough to fill an 18-wheeler. Baled materials are a commodity, like you would hear about on the stock market. The value of this material goes up and down every day depending on who is buying and who is selling. So in 2018, when our biggest buyer walked away, China, the price plummeted. Okay? It went from $60 for a bale of office paper to $3 within 3 months. Okay? Tough times. So these bales will then be, and see here you can see the soda cans, and me geeking out in front of the soda cans, purchased by a secondary processor or manufacturer. The whole goal is for us to sell this material to somebody who will make something out of it. That's the plan, okay? They're going to be made into a new item, and this is where I encourage you to buy sustainably. You spend money every day on something, or at least most of us do. When you are going to buy yourself something, like a laptop bag, please spend a few seconds looking for something that is actually made out of recycled material. When you go to buy paper for your printer, or you're doing it for your office, please consider buying paper made out of paper. If you put it in the bin, and I take it away, and I sort it out, and I make a bale out of it, and then I sell it to a manufacturer who makes something out of it, if you buy it, you have closed the loop. If you don't buy it, and if nobody buys it, the manufacturer has no reason to make it or to buy my bale, and the whole thing comes undone. So the best thing, one of the best ways you can help recycling, besides doing the right thing on the front end, putting the right stuff in, please, because if you put in things we don't ask for, they end up as trash. They're just more expensive trash because we've now sorted it. Okay? Called wish cycling. I really wish this was recyclable. Okay. I understand where you're at. I embrace the emotion. However, it is trash to us too. Okay. So, and if you are out and about, I don't think I said this before, if you are out and about and you have that clam shell and you grabbed lunch, right, on the run, we all do this, and you can take that clam shell and it had a sandwich and fries in it and you ate most of it, thunk it on the nearest garbage can, get rid of the food, I will then take that clamshell, all right? If it's a little messy, you can take a napkin and wipe it up. Feel free to recycle that. If you had chicken parmesan, please trash it, okay? Because otherwise what happens is you throw it into the recycling, you have now gotten tomato sauce all over everything, and the custodian, who I trained personally, is gonna take that entire bag and say, this is all trash now. Because otherwise, if he or she puts it into the dumpster, and we like it all loose now, that tomato sauce is going to look like a murder scene, okay? So it's going to be everywhere, and by the time it gets to the recycling facility, they're going to give it the big thumbs down. So you have just, with your chicken parmesan, ruined a lot of material, okay?
You're not talking about the styrofoam
clamshell. No styrofoam. We don't like styrofoam. Correct. Clear plastic clamshells. You are right about that. So, I probably don't have to tell you, but reduce, reuse, recycle is said in order of what we want you to do. Reduce the amount of waste you make. Reuse things to do that, okay? So this water bottle, can I tell you how many millions of water bottles I would have drunk by now that are in single-use plastic, okay? But instead, I fill it up everywhere I go, right? Same thing with your reusable shopping bags, which you can put infinitely more stuff into and they don't break on you, all right? I once was driving along this long road that goes to my grocery store and there was this guy walking along and he was carrying, it had to be like 16 plastic bags. You know how they put two items in each one? Yeah, so 16 plastic bags and you can tell he's running, man. Because he can tell this is not going to last long. And all of a sudden, the bottom gives out, and two soda bottles, full-size soda bottles, are now on the ground. And he's looking at them thinking, okay, my hands are full already. How am I going to get those home? So I stop my car, and I said, hi! And I pull out, and I give him a reusable bag. And I'm like, here you go. It holds more. And I put his soda into it, and he's staring at me. I'm like, have a good day. And I left. Okay. I just think we should all do that for somebody, because that would move things forward. Just saying. Anyway. All right. So reduce, reuse, recycle, please. There are forces at work in recycling, in the big picture, the world of recycling, right? I talked about, in 2023, I talked about textiles, and I talked about food waste, right? And food waste is about businesses currently. It's not about residences at the moment, okay? And mattresses. Something like 80 to 85% of a mattress is recyclable. Reuse, that material is actually useful. It's wood, it's metal, it's foam, it's fabric. Okay, so that goes on to become, there's all kinds of names in the industry for these things, but you know that kind of weird grayish blanket that is over top of your spare tire in your car, okay, that's called shoddy, and that's made out of stuff like leftover mattresses, right? That foam can be cut up to be used in so many different ways. So lots of good things being done with mattresses, and there are hundreds of thousands of mattresses in every year in Massachusetts going over. So they're no longer allowed in the trash. And anybody here heard of extended producer responsibility before? Okay, got one in the back. So this is about, right now, when you buy something, you have no real control over whether your pair of scissors comes by itself or whether it has a piece of cardboard and then a weird plastic shape with it, and you're like, why was that necessary? Okay, why did the Barbie doll come with 600 pins and wrappers and all that? This is something we don't have control over. Same thing with the messages that say it's recyclable when in fact it is not, okay? No matter what they say on the back, if it doesn't follow, it should follow the rules I told you about earlier, okay? Because the people who manufacture it have nothing to do with those of us who take it on the other end. We get stuck with everything, no matter what they say. So please, follow the rules of Recycle Smart. That is the best way to make sure that you're doing the right thing and helping rather than hurting the system, okay? Extended producer responsibility, I gotta get off track there, is all about working with the manufacturer and making them responsible for the end of life of the product. So if we can get an EPR law passed about mattresses, you won't have to pay when you hand over your mattress, because there will be a system in place that when you buy a new mattress, you pay an extra $20 or something, and then there will be a system for recycling all these mattresses in the state. Connecticut and Rhode Island both already have this. We're just behind on this one. Yes, in the back.
When will that system extend to cars?
Whoa. That's a big EPR system. It's a good question. Yeah, they should be. Anything where the manufacturer is going to have to take it back in the end or figure out what to do with it, it's going to be made better and more recyclable, because they're going to make it easier for themselves, right? And Canada and Europe have really good systems for this. I love like the plastic bottle part of it, for instance. If you are going to manufacture plastic bottles, you have to pay per pound based on what kind of plastic you used. If you used PET plastic, good old clear water bottle plastic, it costs you 3 cents a pound to make your bottles. If you're going to use some weird off-brand, super cool, unusual color plastic, it's going to cost you 30 cents a pound to feed into the system, because they're going to have to figure out what to do with that afterwards. It's about taking the financial burden off of waste off of us and putting it back on the people who are at this point just giving us whatever they want. So that's EPR. If you're interested in that, check out the Massachusetts Product Stewardship Council, okay, on how to make products better, how to do this whole system better at massrecycle.org. All of that is free, okay? So that's also massrecycle.org. It's also those podcasts. And if you're interested in seeing things for yourself, we do tours every month. If you would like to see Covanta and what goes on there, we did a tour of Covanta, or are about to do a tour of Covanta. Our recycling facility, we'd be happy to take you around if you wanted to come up sometime. And we can put together a tour for the town. We want you to know what's happening, all right? It's informed consumers are the best consumers. So, yes, sir.
Leominster, Massachusetts is a pioneer city.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I worked in that industry, plastics industry.
Okay.
And we set up a recycling system in Leominster, one of the first, I guess, in the country, and was sponsored by the Society of Plastics Engineers. And it was quite a learning experience. And back then, this is back in the late 90s.
Okay.
They were recycling several different types of materials, but they could only recycle styrene, polyethylene, and I think one other common plastic. You know, the urethanes, polyesters, and the PETs, mm-hmm. it was just, they couldn't handle. So the biggest problem was to keep that separate from the stuff they could handle, because it could contaminate the whole batch.
Sure.
And we worked in the industry to try to develop a good recycling center, and we had the first in the country, right in Leominster, in the Pioneer Valley, where we were basically recycling plastics and coming out with a usable product that was actually extruded into a sheet that could then be recycled into water bottles or whatever else you want to do.
Awesome. So Leominster is the home of recycling plastic, and
it's a pioneer city
of plastic. It's totally true. It's a very unknown, well-kept secret that, there's a whole lot of plastic manufacturing going on in Leominster.
Yeah.
So thank you very much for that. Any other questions? I'll keep going. One in the back?
Yeah, things like
wood. Okay. Wood is not something I mentioned because we do not take it in the bin. All right. If you have clean wood, see if you can offload that to somebody who wants to make something else, right? Do a reuse, right? Craigslist, say, I have wood. But if you have furniture, try to find a second life for that as furniture. If it is broken and useless, it is trash. Okay, thank you. That's a common one. Hardcover books are another one that we get. Okay, we will take softcover books, paperback books. However, if it's a hardcover book, I need you to cut the cover off of it so that we don't end up with that. We can't use that. All right? Yes, in the back there, sir?
We've been starting to get packing materials.
I'll come back to you, sir.
Instead of the styrofoam peanuts, we get these little...
air pillows?
Starch.
Oh, yeah. Yep. The peanuts that are biodegradable. Yep. Yeah. They will degrade, so you can literally throw them in your garden or something. They look really gross for a while, so don't invite the neighbors over for a bit. But it they will break down, or you can just put them in your sink and, you know, garbage disposal. Right, thank you. And so, also, that the air pillows that we all see, right? Okay, those can go back to the grocery store with all that plastic wrap. And sir, in the back? Batteries, thank you. I do not want them in the bin. I don't even want them in the trash. They, especially lithium ion batteries, okay, or rechargeable batteries, if you puncture them, they spew fire. I don't have a better way to put it. It's unbelievable. Like a lithium ion battery will come up 6 feet in flames. So it's a huge hazard to my industry. It happens way too often. And if you've got, we take in 300 tons of recycling a day, okay? Can you imagine all of that suddenly, you know, at risk because of somebody's battery? So there are other systems for batteries. Talk to your DPW if nothing else. A lot of companies will have a place where you can bring your batteries back. At this point, your A's, double A's, C's and D's can go in the trash safely, but anything that is rechargeable or lithium ion or button cells should not. Thank you for asking. It's a good question. Yeah.
What about recycling in condos?
Sure. Okay. So if recycling is not already happening in your multifamily, whatever you want to call it, I always ask, are you ready to be a rebel leader? Okay. Find a few friends in your building who also feel that there should be recycling. Clearly, legally, there should be recycling there. Okay. So you have that behind you. But at the same time, if you and several other people continuously ask your building manager when that's going to happen, people get annoyed fairly quickly and then decide it's just easier to do it, you know? So that's what I say. Yes?
Crayons
are a reuse item. Okay, so please find honestly, if you go to like your nearest daycare, they probably welcome you with open arms. Okay, you know how fast they eat crayons there. Yes, over here.
You're talking about batteries. When it comes to the
lithium-ion, the button cells, and other, and mercury, with fluorescent lights, fluorescent tubes, and things like that. Wakefield does have one, and I think 2 days during the year, and it's publicized at the town pit, where they do have people there who will take all of them.
So there's maybe a household hazardous waste day, or at least
an offshoot of that.
Yeah, okay, sure. Universal. We call it universal waste because universally everybody has these things in their house, right? But they're not good to go into the recycling or the trash. So
right,
thank you. But there is a special day. Thank you. Terrific. So there's a special day for that. So talk to your DPW, look at the DPW website and figure out when that is and save your stuff up safely. And the whole point of like CFLs, I always call them curly fluorescent lights, I think there's something else, that's what they actually stand for, but they actually have mercury vapor in them. So if you have a fluorescent light bulb, put it somewhere safe, not somewhere it's going to get bumped while you're waiting. What's that? Home Depot will take them. Just don't drop them in the bin. Okay, thank you. Yes, here?
The large bins that we collect all these things in, when those get broken, can they be recycled?
Oh.
Like the buckets that you store?
Probably not. At this point, that's a no. Those really big. That's why I say if you can hold it in your hand and call it a container with a lid, it needs to be something small enough to put in your hand. Yeah.
Do you know of any place that?
No. There is no market for it at this point. I mean, you should definitely talk to your DPW and ask them what they want to do with it, and maybe they have found a source, you know, to buy it back. But it's the market has been low for many, many years. Yes, in the front.
In terms of reusing, there is a website called Buy Nothing Wakefield.
Buy Nothing Wakefield.
It's
fantastic.
A group,
yep.
And people are recycling furniture and kids' toys and plastic.
Or reusing it.
Reusing.
Mm-hmm.
they're reusing.
Yep.
And it's a great way to not have things continuously be manufactured that have useful life.
You'd be surprised at things. Thank you so much for that. There's a number of Buy Nothing Wakefield is going to be the most local way you can move things around, right? And I have seen things like I had a bunch of calendars that my mother-in-law had gotten because she donates to everybody, and then she ends up with these calendars, and I put them up there, and somebody came and said their kids like to cut out all the pictures and make collages. So don't underestimate the creativity of somebody else to take what you don't need and do something useful with it. Yeah.
Also, in terms of books.
Books.
The Friends of the BB Library have an annual book sale.
Oh, annual book sale at the library.
We have a space where we collect books.
Okay.
People can bring boxes of books. They're sorted and they're sold annually. Another way for books to be reused and not end up in dumps or in trash.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something to also be aware of.
Absolutely. Book reuse. Huge fan. Okay. I single-handedly support my reusable used bookstore next door to me, and that is something that if you're also looking to make that difference on how can I change my behavior to help save the planet, every time that you buy books that were already read, you're saving the embodied carbon of that, correct? So you are saving all the energy and materials that would have been gone into a new book. And you're keeping it going. Same thing with consignment stores and used clothing stores. Pretty much everything I have except what Republic gave me is consignment. And it is just, it's usually less expensive. And you know, when you decide that you have had your fun with it and you're tired of it, back it goes. Goes around again, okay? So those are things that you can do to make a difference, without massively changing your lifestyle, okay? You don't have to give up your car, just, use books, use clothing. Giving up your car is good too, but not for everybody. Yes, in the back.
You mentioned that a lot of textiles are made out of the plastic water bottles.
Yes.
And polyester products. Is that something that's been a practice for some time, or is it like
yes.
more recent?
Well, it's more recent. Okay. Lots of people have gotten on the bandwagon more recently.
That's
all right.
Like,
and oh, sure. So there are certain groups that are, I don't know, whether it's Patagonia, REI, they've been doing it for a long time, L.L. Bean. And then there's other groups that have gotten on. And there's some who only use recycled plastic for their stuff, or it's ocean plastic, or whatever they sell it for. and I should tell you that, so The water bottles and the soda bottles we get, okay, those are, like I said, super useful. In the past, recycled plastic had to compete with virgin plastic in a market, all right? And manufacturers would buy whatever was cheaper. If the price of oil was up, they would buy recycled plastic because it costs less, or vice versa, okay? As of now, enough major brands like Walmart and Nike and Coca-Cola have committed to using recycled plastic in their containers or their products. And that means that there's an established market for our material. We don't have to fight it out with virgin plastic anymore. As of last year, those two markets disconnected. We're happy to say they want our recycled plastic for the fact that it is recycled. So that's very cool. The world is going forward, despite everything you hear, okay? And congratulations, thank you very much for putting pressure on all of those companies to do the right thing, because that's really how it happens. There has never been a time in history where you have had more power as a consumer to make a manufacturer do the right thing. So feel free to use that. Any other questions? I'm gonna call it, I think I have to call it quits after this. Yes? Okay, compostable stuff. Okay, first of all, I don't want in general paper with food on it. Okay, compostable stuff is only really worth buying and using if you're going to compost it afterwards. All right, otherwise, if it gets trashed with everything else, it's still getting trashed. All right, so think about that. That's a very big money maker nowadays, is buying compostable stuff. Please do not take compostable plastic and throw it in my bin, because I want you to compost it instead, all right? It won't compost in your backyard. You have to bring it to a commercial facility, just so you know, okay? All right, it has been so cool talking. Oh, okay, go ahead, sir.
How about one of my wife's pet peeves? How about the paper dozen egg cartons?
That I'll take. And if you go to the Recycle Smart MA website, look those things up after I'm gone so you're not hitting yourself on the forehead thinking, why didn't I ask her? Okay? You've been a fantastic audience. Thank you so much for caring. I appreciate it. Would you like to stop?